The Tale of Rosie Bottom. A very lovely Rosie Bottom was strolling early one summer's evening through an acrino wen, in a place where many square stone and steel ribbed uglinesses grew cheek to jowl. A Mr. Danny Tuttle brightly accosted her acquaintance with a low and glossy bow. "Would you believe," said he, "that I've a fleck of something in my eye that has a most dainty pair of legs twinkling along through it?" Shyly Rosie answered, "Oh, sir, if looks like yours could somehow be artificially disseminated, what large families a lot of unsuspecting young ladies would have by now. But in regard to myself, I'm afraid that something like disenchantment holds sway over my own mores, at least as they apply themselves to what was once held to be the ruder of the two sexes. For I find myself, how shall I say, the object of a misdirected paternal instinct." "You don't say," exclaimed the Mr. Danny Tuttle, as he patiently waited for a dry cleaner's truck to come to a splashing stop against the fire hydrant. And he interrupted himself long enough to say, "That reminds me. I'd better phone Ma tonight. She's out walking old Spot, and she almost helped him catch a pussycat, except somebody left the manhole cover off. At any rate, that's her story. Personally, I think she was crocked, pistol whipping that cop with a traffic lantern and getting oil all over the fire chief's tuxedo like that. But you were saying that your old man sort of, well, maybe like he thinks he's in one of those old-fashioned Greek plays or something." "Oh, he's not my real father," Rosie assured him. "Well," Danny replied, "I suppose even a case of step incest could get your dander up." And he escorted her into a gaudy emporium, where together they enjoyed three frosted grape frappes. Then, when they were outside again, the Rosy Bottom said quietly, "But that's not the worst. He's got one of those light-up neckties, the fiend." "Aha! Tell me, what does his say?" eagerly asked the Mr. Danny Tuttle. Rosie Bottom hesitated, blushed, and then tremblingly told him, "It says, 'How's about a kiss, kiddo?'" Quickly, the Mr. Danny Tuttle led her into a darkened alley. "Have yourself a gander at mine," he said huskily. After a long moment, Rosie said, "Oh, I'm terribly sorry. I must have given you the wrong impression entirely. I couldn't possibly be your Valentine." Moral: 11 times out of 10, it's lustful passion and not greed at all that makes racehorses.